I would like to introduce Marcie Newton. She's an instructor in the English department at the College of St. Rose in Albany, New York. She's been teaching hybrid and online classes since 2007. And she's completing her doctoral thesis in psychoanalytic studies at the University of Sheffield in the UK. So with that, Marcie, I'd like to pass it over to you.
Thank you ever so much, Sharon. Let me just put on the talk and I can the video. There we go. Oh, let me shed my blanket there. All right. So let me see if I can just go there. All right. Well, good afternoon. Today I'm going to present on a few tools in Blackboard that I have found have helped me to maximize student engagement, discussion boards, blogs, wikis, and journals. Let's see. Alright, so on the agenda are two items, Bloom's Digital Taxonomy and the Blackboard features. The objective, of course, is to compare and contrast these Blackboard features utilizing Bloom's Digital Taxonomy, as learning strategies to maximize a student engagement. Let's see, now usually these, when I had it set up, these arrows would pop up, but it looks like they're going to be on each slide. That's okay. Now, I teach hybrid courses, and my teaching pedagogy is influenced by Bloom's Digital Taxonomy. And as you can see, that Bloom's Digital Taxonomy ranges from these lower order thinking skills to these higher order ones, and it's a modification of Bloom's Taxonomy that came out in the 1950s. As opposed to seeing, as what you see here, remembering right through to creating, the original taxonomy, began with knowledge, comprehension, application, analysis, synthesis, and evaluation. Those are all nouns. What Bloom's Digital Taxonomy did was translate those nouns into verbs. And of course, verbs are action words. They're doing. So the doing, the action actually, means that, the students are engaged. These are words of engagement. And if you'll see here in the communication spectrum, these two, all these are, action words that encourage, student engagement. Now, I'd like to take you through Bloom's Digital Taxonomy and share with you how I utilize these stages of student learning in my Blackboard features. Now, the first on the list is remembering. And as you'll see here, it says recognizing, listing, describing. These are all, functions of remembering, and strategies that you can use to remember include, for example, and I won't go through them all, this is going to be saved, so you can come back to it and look at all this information in more detail, but bullet pointing is a strategy. Highlighting, bookmarking. These are strategies for remembering information. But for me, I want to, go beyond that, beyond just describing what remembering means. What students really want to know is why remembering is significant. So, remembering is significant because what the students are doing is acquiring knowledge in these early stages. And knowledge and the remembering itself is a foundation for other types of learning. For example, understanding. Now, understanding, translates to interpreting, summarizing, and ways that you can do these things are through, advanced, searches, tagging, commenting, for example. But again, it's all very well to have these terms. Bloom's Digital Taxonomy, we're at the understanding stage, but why is this significant? And I think that's really what I sort of want to focus on, is the significance of learning. So in terms of understanding, which is the next rung in that ladder of lower order thinking, what does that mean? When you're understanding information, really what students are doing is interpreting that information, and whether they're summarizing, explaining, twittering, or tagging, what they're doing also is communicating that information. Now, if they're communicating that information, for me, that shows that students are interested, you know, in the information, interested enough that they will also care about the material that they're reading, about the task at hand. So all this is in terms of lower order thinking, but the emphasis needs to be on the significance of these stages, as well as what the descriptions are and the strategies that students can use through each stage of this thinking. All right, let me go to the next one. The next level, still in the lower order thinking, is applying. Now here, applying, you know, translates to implementing, using. Again, you can tell these are all action words that we're doing. And examples here, just to name a few, running, playing, uploading, sharing, editing. So how I, you know, interpret that is that in the applying, that this is concerned with the delivery of information, and integral to this delivery of information are tools. Tools like Blackboard's discussion board, blogs, wikis, journals. Technology and knowledge is really integrating to enhance student engagement. And again, these are all action terms. These are all doing. And if students are doing, they are engaging. All right. I keep wanting to hit my cursor. There you go. All right. So let's, you know, look at these, you know, in terms of lower order thinking in relation to discussion board. Now look at these three before I go on to the next level, which is the higher order thinking. Now, first of all, you know, with the discussion board, let's identify, you know, what it is. So it's an asynchronous communication tool, which basically means that, you know, there aren't any, you know, time limits, you know, involved with it. But, you know, of course, with any assignment that you give, you're going to have some kind of time limit, you know, to, you know, before you sort of move on to the next. But in discussion board, students post threads and they comment on their peers' threads. I mean, that's how I utilize, you know, the discussion board tool. The purpose, of course, is to first and foremost generate discussion. But in that generation of discussion, the students are developing critical, you know, thinking skills through reading and writing processes that start with the lower order thinking. But it's also a place that I think really fosters a sense of community, and when students, you know, feel part of a community and they're engaged in interesting discussion and they feel that they're getting something out of it, then that equates to student engagement. So let me just, there we go. Now, I'm not going to hang around, you know, too long on these pages, but in terms of communication spectrum, notice that how many features that, you know, point towards, you know, what a discussion board can offer for students in terms, and I've got to just name some examples: collaboration, they can debate, they can comment, they can question, they can reply to posts, they can contribute to discussions, you know, with their ideas. So I just wanted to point to those key features in the discussion board. So you'll see here I've got remembering, understanding, and applying, which are the first three layers in that Bloom's digital taxonomy. It's still in sort of terms of lower order thinking. Now, you know, what I have here is a task in this discussion board. I believe in giving students, particularly in discussion boards, questions on controversial, you know, topics that really kind of broaden their intellectual capabilities and worldviews, and kind of take them outside, you know, of their sort of environment and sort of look at things that are going on in the world. So here, for example, the task I gave was for students actually to get into groups and locate information on the Bosnian War. This was for one of my classes called Diverse Voices. And you'll see here that I've put a sort of a box around what is significant, you know, in this, you know, particular task, is that they are to examine a memoir which was actually written by a Serb and examine it in consideration of historical perspectives and bias. And this, you know, the key skills that they'll be working on in this activity include research, they're acquiring knowledge, they have to gain some comprehension of that knowledge, and then an interpretation of the significance of that knowledge. So I've kept them, in this point, I've given them some scaffolding upon which to build, you know, their critical thinking skills, which is first the acquisition of knowledge. And of course, this task, you know, is collaborative. You know, the students, typically I give, discussion boards where they're engaging in discussion. I will come to one shortly. But I just wanted to show you this to show that in discussion board, students can work collaboratively. In this particular assignment, I gave students, put them into groups and said, okay, one set of you, you're going to find information on the culture, you know, of Bosnia. Another set of students, you're going to find information on the war or on the geography. So they all work collaboratively to, you know, find information that we're then going to, you know, sift through and analyze and evaluate. So, okay. So in terms of lower order thinking, what we have here is one of the students' responses. She came in and her task in her group was to find information on the Bosnian War itself. And, you know, she, you know, starts off right off the bat, you know, locating this, you know, war in, you know, a time frame, and, you know, through her research, you know, explains how the Bosnian Serb army at the time controlled 70% of the country. The point is, of course, is that what she has presented is an interesting fact. What she has also shown is that she has shown interest in the material by, you know, going out and providing that. And, you know, also, you know, down here, after providing that information, she also shows, me just, you know, here, what she found to be significant, you know, about the fact. And she says, I found these facts very interesting after reading about the atrocities committed, you know, by the Muslims against the Serbs. If anyone's familiar with, you know, the Bosnian, you know, war, it was a very embittered battle in the early 90s. And what we studied is a memoir by, you know, a Serbian who said, you know, okay, we know that the Serbian government did wrong, but that does not, you cannot tarnish every single, you know, Serb the same brush. So basically, as the student acknowledges that, you know, given, you know, the Serbian author gave the reader one bias, one perspective, but given the reader only one side of the story, once you do the research, then you'll see that the situation is much more complex and that there are different sides to a story. So, of course, again, it's a controversial topic, but, you know, I teach English and, you know, this, you know, discussion board is an absolutely wonderful place to encourage students to engage in discussions on difficult topics and to hear all their voices as well that you might not necessarily hear in a traditional classroom. And of course here, the source is also listed, you know, as a requirement so that all the students can, you know, go into the source and even come back to these sources as well. All the discussion boards, you know, when they end, you know, I reopen them so that students can go back in at any time. Okay, so let's take this in. I'm going to take this into the higher order thinking, analyzing, evaluating, and creating. Now, analyzing, you know, starts with comparing, organizing, deconstructing, and ways to do that include, you know, mashing, linking, validating, etc. Now, of course, what's, you know, important for students is what is significant, you know, about that, and for us also, what is significant about, you know, the, you know, what we hope to teach our students. So in terms of analyzing, you know, students, really what they're doing is finding meaning in the material that they're reading and that they're studying, and finding relationships between not just ideas, you know, in the material that they're reading, but relationships between ideas, between their own ideas and between the ideas of their peers as they're discussing, topics. And of course, that leads to, you know, when you're discussing ideas, that synthesis of, you know, information that's, you know, part of the evaluating process. So evaluating here, of course, checking, critiquing, you know, etc. But again, you know, what the student's essentially doing is assessing the material, and that leads to making the decision about the material that they've read, you know, the different biases, different, you know, perspectives. So they're learning, you know, even just, you know, talking about topics, they're learning valuable, you know, skills that are transferable, you know, into the workplace, into, you know, lifelong learning, into relations, you know, with others. And of course, higher order thinking, so we covered that lower, you know, order thinking. But even just going, you know, back, you've got this, you've got the element of research that leads to the interesting fact, which is really what the student is doing, is analyzing the fact, interpreting what she's read, and then evaluating the information based on the different research that she has found. You know, we were reading a memoir that was written from one particular perspective, you know, and it's important that, you know, for the students to go out and not just take what they read at face value, but test the knowledge and find out what different perspectives are. And of course, in the Bodleian War, there's certainly, you know, different, you know, perspectives on that. So last, you know, but not least, the creating part. This is a new feature that was added, you know, to Bloom's, you know, taxonomy. It's not the existing version. And creation, of course, you know, you're designing, you're constructing, you're building. Again, you know, big action words, you know, where, you know, in itself creating implies engagement. And for me, when I think of, you know, creating, what the students are really doing is that through the information they are discovering, they could be discovering new ideas, their peers could be coming up with ideas that, you know, or views that as innovative, or that could lead to change and progress. So by, you know, engaging in this dialogue and in the discussion forum, that it's just a wonderful place for, you know, students to, you know, really, you know, discover, you know, things they hadn't maybe known, you know, before, even, you know, sort of form of self-discovery, you know, as well. But the point is, all these are also actions, and actions equate to student engagement. Okay. Now I want to take a step back and just say that when you're talking about maximizing student engagement, it is important to make it easy for students to locate, you know, the task. So I've taken you through Bloom's digital taxonomy, but, and this is all very well, but if students can't get in, you know, they don't feel comfortable, you know, navigating, you know, their way through a discussion board, that in itself could, you know, pose some issues in terms of maximizing student engagement. So I've listed here two ways. Here, of course, you can, you know, lead them to tools and then ask them to hit the discussion board. Or what I do is I have a, you know, modules, you know, in my courses. And here, for example, you know, week three module, the students would click, for example, here, reading and writing about narrative. So make it easy for the students to get to, you know, the discussion board. And this would also apply to, you know, blogs and other things as well. Easily identified with basic instructions. Again, it's all very well. You can have the most dynamic topic, the most controversial topic that really challenges, you know, the students on an intellectual level. But if they can't find where they need to go, then their enthusiasm already is going to wane. So here, of course, I've got an online class listed in the table of contents. The instructions are very easy. Click to launch. The students, you know, can't fail to miss, you know, these instructions. But that being said, I can't stress enough that particularly with students who come into Blackboard who may be unfamiliar with these tools, that having a tutorial really, really helps to keep them engaged, because if they are having trouble, then, you know, they may give up, they may not even go into the discussion board and complete the task. So I just wanted to, you know, take a step back and just enforce, you know, reinforce that as well. Okay.
Hey, Marcie. Sorry, this is Karen. I just wanted to quickly interrupt. So There appears to be some people who have trouble hearing you. I can hear you just fine, but is there any way you can turn the volume on your mic up, which is under your, it's in the Collaborate, one of the Collaborate panels, just under your video probably. And there's like a slide bar, if you could just turn that volume up.
How's that?
That sounds good to me. Hopefully everyone else said.
Do I sound the same though? Maybe I should lean forward a bit more? Just don't want to stick my face in the
That's fine.
In the window.
That's better, everybody says.
Okay. That's okay. Sorry about that. All right. Okay. So we talked about tutorials and making it easy to produce access, you know, the tools. But I cannot also stress enough, clear guidelines. There have to be clear objectives. Why are you giving, you know, what is the purpose in giving the students a particular task? What are they going to learn from the task? And what is significant about the task that you're giving the students? So why does it matter to them? And these have to be clearly laid out. So, for example, here on one of my classes, I've categorically said, my goal is for you to examine and acquire, and in this case, an appreciation of narrative writing as a piece of rhetoric. And again, you'll see in the second box, I've got, as you'll learn. So the student says, okay, she's got a goal, this is what she wants us to do, and this is, and more importantly, this is what I'm going to learn from this assignment. So, and here, you know, I won't, you know, read the whole thing, but, you know, as you'll learn, narrative writing is a means of conveying information that is written in a way to persuade our readers to listen to and accept our views. That's just one, you know, part of that. But of course, the importance is clear objectives, clear learning outcomes. And of course, significance of the task. For many students, what's significant about a task is, what do I get out of it? How does it relate to me in some way? So, for example, here I've got, why do you think the piece you chose is important? What I did with narrative writing was that we had a selection of stories that the students had to choose from. I didn't just give one story. They could pick out of like three or four, because each student gravitates towards maybe a different story. We don't all like the same type of literature. So giving a student a choice in itself enhances and maximizes student engagement. Students have said to me, you know, in class, sometimes the enthusiasm wanes for them because they find they have to read only the text, you know, like one text that's assigned, you know, by the instructor. So I do try and at least give a selection. And of course, why do you think the piece you chose is important? It's not important what I think as an instructor. It's not me, not my skills that we're developing. The student skills that are being developed. So the significance of the task, you know, is of course an extremely important component of helping to maximize student engagement. And also to, you know, interact, you know, with the text. Now here I know it's like there's a lot of information, you know, on this slide. This is the purpose of, you know, coming back to it. So, you know, with the student, when the student interacts with the text, then it's, you know, for example, in this one, this story was about a dog, you know, who was, you know, a pit bull that was about to be euthanized. But, and, you know, the student wrote of the three stories assigned, the one that I believe stood out from the rest was Leela by Rosemary Straney. So the student's already, you know, engaged. She said, you know, this one stood out to me. I have a voice. And she goes on to say, you know, how the story had affected her. But more than that, she also provides an analysis, what is significant about the story, and she says, you know, this story not only instills feelings of empathy, but evokes feelings of effects of death and remembrance of one's loved ones. Now, of course, this is, you know, one of the responses, but what this also leads to is that all the students have to comment, you know, on at least two to three other peers' posts. So what we have here is an example of a student-to-student interaction. This particular student replied to that post on Leela, and it had, you know, how she responded to the text had an effect on him. He made a connection, not just, you know, with the text, but also with the student. And he replies, you know, validating the comment that that student made. This piece was truly, you know, heartbreaking. And he also related, you know, to the situation. He says, you know, I was literally in the exact same situation and was able to understand the message that the author was writing. So in this discussion board environment, we have a student interacting with, their students interacting with the text and also interacting with each other. And when that happens, you really are essentially maximizing, you know, student engagement through using discussion board as a tool. So here you'll see we've got the spectrum from remembering right through to creating. And what I wanted to emphasize, you know, here was that the students, you know, in their classes, that they have a personal investment, you know, in the material. So whether it's, you know, intellectual debates that are being sort of focused on, you know, or, you know, narrative, you know, writing, got to give the students a voice and also for them to think about the value that they place, you know, on the literature that is being discussed. Now I'll move on to blogs. Now, of course, you know, what is a blog? Well, you know, like discussion board, it's an asynchronous communication tool. Instead of students posting threads, they're posting entries and they comment on their peers' entries. I've got purpose and I've got it kind of vague. I've got it whatever you want it to be, then of course I put in brackets. You're still, even though you've been more creative with it, students can still be developing critical thinking skills, still part of community, and of course develop student, maximize student engagement. The point I want to make about blogs is that I use blogs as a creative space for students. So again, you know, just like the discussion board, make it easy for, you know, the students to locate. I'll just skip over that one. But what's a real nice feature about the blog, which is why I emphasize the creativity, is that you can customize it. So, for example, here you'll see, you know, I was able to put like an image that corresponded with the task at hand, and you can customize, you know, the theme. So that each, you know, blog I give can have like different images, different colors, and it just makes for a nice visual, you know, for the students. So that's a really neat feature of the blog, and I think that having this, you know, these visual assets in itself can help, you know, maximize student engagement. Now again, I won't stop here, but here on the communication spectrum are some key features that students can, you know, engage in the blog. Now, with the blog, what I really like to do is give students ownership. And again, you'll see by my hours that you still have to, it doesn't matter what assignment you give, whether it's in a discussion board, you know, or blog, you have to have clear objectives and learning outcomes. I can't stress that enough. But here, what I did was that I give tasks in blogs that are really directly related to them and to the, you know, their lives. So, for example, I've got here select, you know, one of the following scenarios. So I still kind of, you know, manage, you know, the students' tasks, but I still give them, you know, freedom, you know, within this. Not just choose one. It's not just you're working in this particular scenario, you know. Give students choices, because you know what, the results are also varied and interesting as well. So for example here, you know, students can either write a pamphlet, you know, for students who come to the college health clinic. Students could write, you know, a column in a Newsweek magazine that, you know, talks about how college students are defined, you know, in today's society. So those are just two tasks that I give that students can read and think, oh my god, this just directly relates to me. I can have something to say about this because I've experienced, you know, something, you know, here. So giving students ownership, I think, really helps to maximize, you know, student engagement. And I will just show you some examples, you know, again, of, you know, what some students have done. So here's an example of a student interacting with this particular blog assignment. So what I've emphasized here is that, you know, a student has, even though that student is engaging with, you know, the material, and he's, you know, he starts off by saying that he thinks students today have been given a bad reputation as perhaps materialistic, self-centered, and immature, and then he puts in his stance and says, well, however, you know, being a college student is much more difficult, you know, especially in today's day and age. You know, this particular student is on a sports scholarship, but he stresses how, you know, in today's day and age, employers be are so competitive, and that you have to work even harder to get your resume out. What he's also done is basically provided an argument. He started off with the opposition's argument and transitioned into his own position, giving his rationale. So even though he's writing on a topic that really matters to him, he's also still developing key analytical and evaluation skills, you know, in the process. And I think that if you're going to give, you know, any task, that you have to target these multiple learning skills. There we go, you see that his rationale there. One of the things I really, really love about, you know, discussion boards and blogs is the student-student interaction and the way that they respond. Now here, you know, in response to that student's post about students having to, you know, work much harder and that they should not be perceived, you know, in a negative, you know, way, not, of course, not by all adults, but, you know, by some. And this student recognizes the value of that the student's argument, and he says, by going the extra mile, example, caring about how they perform, getting sports scholarships, and doing community services, students are trying to get ahead. So it was just wonderful to you know, to see that encouragement, to see that the students are impacting each other, you know, by, you know, their arguments. And again, inspiring, great post. And imagine that student, you know, coming back in and reading the comments and seeing that and feeling really good about what he has written. And that, you know, the entry, of course, as I've got here, it inspires, you know, other you know, students. But it's also good for me to recognize as a faculty, you know, member, that these students, not just to think of these students as you know, numbers that come into my classroom, but as real human beings who are struggling, who are also coming to college because they want to make something of their lives. So given those type of blog assignments where you're handing over ownership to students and allowing them to, you know, express maybe their own struggles and what's important to them, it also makes for a stronger connection between you and the student, as well as between the students themselves. And of course, here's, you know, a different rhetorical situation. You know, that student provided an argument. This student provided more sort of informative, you know, response, because, you know, the point of the blog was to consider different rhetorical situations. So the students all, you know, engaged in that task, you know, in a variety of ways. What I want to emphasize here is the statement that where the student says, many of us experience themes of being nervous or anxious before, for example, tests, exams, and finals. What the student is doing, essentially, is building a sense of community. She writes in her title, how do you feel? And many of us experience feelings. So it's absolutely, you know, wonderful when she's, you know, writing an informative piece like that, that she's drawing in the other student and she's recognizing the presence of the other students as well. And of course, student-student interaction, I can't emphasize that enough. I think that that's probably one of the major factors of student engagement, is that they feel comfortable engaging with their peers, especially in an online environment. When you're in a traditional classroom, I love traditional, you know, classrooms, you know, having that face-to-face, you know, contact. But in the discussion board, every student has presence. Every student has a voice, whether it's posting an entry or responding to, you know, somebody else's entry. Now, for example, here, when the student said, if this, you know, was a real pamphlet, I would feel really informed. Again, validation of that, her peers' comment. And you know, here, you know, in the response below, I think if we could just relax before a test, everything would be perfectly fine. So they're also engaging in dialogue on what is a very important subject for students, which is, you know, taking exams. So it's really good to hear them, you know, interacting about, you know, what's really important in their own lives. And the blog is a great place, you know, to do this. It makes, you know, for me, the blog is a much more personal and creative environment in that respect, whereas, as you'll see from discussion board, it's much more sort of intellectually driven, you know, with development of, you know, research and whatnot. But also, I just want to sort of very quickly tell you that I use the blog in my English classes for as well as a place for discovery. So here I had the students build concrete poems. We were studying concrete poems in one of my classes, and I said, you know, sometimes the best way to really show an appreciation of an artist's craft is to step into that poet's, you know, that poet's shoes. But in the meantime, I mean, I'm absolutely never ceases to amaze me what these students can achieve, you know, when put to the task. And here, of course, I have that what really comes through for me is that the student is going through a process of self-exploration as well as developing a critical appreciation for the craft. And the blog, you know, by putting this, having the blog really, again, enable students to be creative and to express that creativity, you know, in that online environment. And again, I can't stress enough participation and encouragement when you have students engage in student to student, you know, interaction. For example, at the top, you know, above, one student says, you know, my favorite part was when the student mentioned, you know, wrote one line. And the second comment, you know, you got the words, it's so awesome. I mean, just imagine if you were that student who'd taken that time to write that poem, to get that type of encouragement. It's really inspiring. And it also encourages the student to remain engaged, you know, in the course as well. I can't stress enough that fostering that sense of community is so important, you know, when you give tasks. All right, so discourse is about similarities and the differences. So in terms of, you know, differences, I'll start there. Discussion board, I really use it for the sort of acquisition of knowledge of particular topics that lead into critical debate on really sort of big important issues, whether they're political issues, cultural issues. Whereas with the blogs, I use it as a place for self-exploration and creativity on events that have direct meaning to, you know, students' lives. So, you know, I vary it up. You know, if I was just to have, you know, week by week, just discussion board every single week, I think that even though it would benefit the students intellectually, that engagement may wane a little bit. I think that variety is also key. But of course, the similarities is that whether you're using discussion board or blogs, that these, you know, six stages of remembering right through to creating are present, you know, in those assignments, and they, you know, equate to, you know, student engagement. All right, Wiki, one of my favorites. Again, what is it? It's like the other two, it's, you know, it can be asynchronous, and Wiki, you know, we associate Wiki with collaboration. You know, we see the sort of Wikipedia, you know, where different people come in and enhance the information that's given on particular topics. And purpose, of course, you know, for me, it's teamwork building. I also find that when you have a collaborative effort, that really challenges and enhances the organizational skills, really develops students' organizational skills as a team. And of course, you know, in Wikis, that they're shaping arguments to find relationships, you know, between ideas and between the own ideas, you know, in a group. So what I want to share with you, again, just to go through, you've got that communication spectrum, the key features that the Wiki, you know, involves. But what I want to go through is an in-class Wiki that I did. So of course you can do this online. What I did, because I teach the hybrid course, was that actually in the classroom I divided students up, you know, into groups, and, you know, asked them to, you know, go through a narrative, you know, to pick a narrative piece, and in preparation for their own narrative writing, of course, again, I've got the objectives and, you know, the learning outcomes that the students will gain, you know, from this particular task. So let me just show you, this is absolutely wonderful. This is one, each group would came up to the front of the class and presented, you know, on their particular story. Now this was a story called Lydia's Story, and there were four students in this group. And of course the first thing that you can see is an image, you know, of, you know, you can tell right away, you know, what this story is about. And I thought it was wonderful that when you give students the ability to be creative, that, you know, they really do take control and you know, of the task and do a wonderful job, you know, with it. Now, you want to focus on that lower order to higher order thinking, you know, with the wikis. So in this particular instance, in terms of the lower order thinking, the students working together, you know, went through stages, you know, what the story is about, when it happened, where it happened, why, you know, it happened. But also in terms of moving towards, you know, the higher order, you know, thinking, that they are establishing the significance of the story, and at the bottom, why? Why does the story matter? And they back it up with evidence, you know, as well. But of course, here, and I've highlighted organization and collaboration. Four students came together and produced this and organized this information. So the wiki, you know, when you give a, you know, wiki assignment, it is a wonderful opportunity for students to come together and work collaboratively on, you know, on a project. And of course, in one of my classes, that the class is actually called Research, Expository Writing, and All Communication. So by working on wikis and then going up to the front of the class and presenting, you know, on them, that, you know, students are also preparing themselves, they're developing oral communication skills in preparation for their oral presentations. But it's such a wonderful feature, you know, to have wikis in Blackboard, and the students have said this is certainly, you know, one of their favorites. And it really, again, maximizes student engagement. So here the wikis, you know, one of the sort of, I guess, just striking features, not so much many differences, but striking features, that it's a place for collaboration and, you know, helps to sort of, really helps to organize, you know, the students' material when they're working in a group effort. And again, these are skills that are transferable to the workplace, to lifelong learning, to the communications with others. Okay, let me just take us through the last one, which are the journals. What is it? Again, you know, asynchronous tool, but instead of, I mean, you can set the journal up so that other students see it, but I use the journal as a space for students to reflect on material or reflect on their experiences in the classroom, how they've interacted with their peers, how they've interacted with me. But it's also a place, how I use the journal is for student teacher direct interaction, so they're in a, you know, comfortable environment where they can talk to me one-on-one and get that individual attention. There's also a place where they can think about their goals, their ideals, and their values in relation to the material that they've covered. Now let me just briefly, again, the key features here on the communication spectrum. I can't, you know, stress enough that students in every form, whether it's blog, you know, discussion board, journal, they are interacting, they are engaging with the material through these Blackboard features. So for example, with the unit reflections, what I ask students to do at the end of each unit is to write a reflection piece on what they learned, you know, in that unit, the text, you know, exploring the text, the tasks and experiences, you know, there. And you'll see below that, you know, one of the things that the journal helps them to do is reflect on their personal goals and their ideals and see how they develop or change throughout the duration of the course. So, and here you'll see, they've got reflections that are ungraded, and I think that's so important because if they're ungraded, then I think that that allows the students to be much more honest, in their journal entries. So for example, here's one, student reflections on one of the units, which, seem to have narrative themes. So this is a reflection on the narrative. The students are free to express their opinion and feelings. One student said, I actually had some fun writing about my experiences as if I didn't anticipate having any fun and working in groups. And this one student said, I find writing about narrative much easier than, for example, writing a report or an opinionated essay. So I appreciated the honesty that, the student, brought forth in terms of, his opinion. And I did in my comment, I want to show the student, that, you care, make sure you, in my journal that I respond to the student to show that I am interested and that I value, their response. And of course, I tell them here that the opinionated essay is coming, but hopefully he'll gain some, benefit from it. But also, what's really great to see in the reflection is that one of the students, had written about how writing narratives was confidence building, and also I gave a task, that was to self and peer assessment, and he said that evaluating my peers' narratives showed me that I have the ability to help and contribute to their work, which is absolutely wonderful, but it also affords you, through the journal, a teaching opportunity. So here, for example, I acknowledge his statement, and then I said that in narrative writing, you're also learning important revision and proofreading skills that the student can transfer to his own writing. So the journal enables you to make a much closer connection with the student, and also offers teachable moments, back to the course. So here, similarities and differences overall between the journals. So we know that, discussion board is that place for, the acquisition of knowledge, debate and research and developing those critical thinking skills and a really, intellectual platform. The blogs, that self-exploration, more creative, feature. In the wikis, collaboration, the journals, I use the journals as a place for student reflection and for that immediate student-teacher, interaction. I choose not to have the journals available to the other students. And again, of course, the key similarities is that they are still going through these six, stages of student learning, whether it's through the entry or through the response that you give or that, students give. All of these equate to student engagement. Now, just to recap, that my aim in this presentation was to demonstrate the significance of, teaching strategies to enhance student learning and maximize, their, student engagement. And I did so through an interpretation of Bloom's digital taxonomy. So it wasn't so much you have the descriptions from remembering right through to creating and what those translate to in terms of action words. But most importantly for me is what is significant about those terms and what is significant about those terms in relation to what the students get out of the exercise, to get out of the task, to maximize their student engagement. And of course, I use Bloom's digital taxonomy as a model to compare and contrast the Blackboard features. And what's great about it, if you're focused on maximizing student engagement, is that what you're doing is that you're enhancing the students' learning experiences. You're also helping them to, for the task that you give and through using, integrating the technology, with the task, is that you're fostering a sense of community and also encouraging reflection, whether that reflection is in, one-on-one between you and the student, or whether it's in between, the students thinking about reflection upon their comments, reflection on their peers, comments in these features. And that's my presentation on my Blackboard and how I use discussion board, blogs, wikis, and journals.
Hey, Marcie, this is Sharon. No, this was fantastic. Thank you so much. There are definitely some questions that came through, and I'm going to just go back through the chat window and ask them. So there was a question earlier. I would like to share the information from Bloom's Digital Taxonomy and with others. How do I cite Bloom's Digital Taxonomy in APA style?
Ooh. The Bloom's Digital Taxonomy I don't know how to answer that. Sort of common, information, the images out there, sort of public, information. I guess, I don't have it, cited here. But in APA, I don't know how to answer that.
Okay, well, maybe some other people can answer, put some ideas in the chat window.
You definitely, in terms of, citing, the name, the year, like that, but it's, at this point, it's sort of common information that people use as a teaching pedagogy.
Okay, so another question. If you have the journal entries to be ungraded, how do you ensure that students participate in the journal entry assignments?
Well, what I do with this particular class is that at the beginning of class, when we're actually on campus, this one is done on campus, I give them 10 minutes before we start the new unit, and they spend that 10 minutes of time reflecting on the previous unit. So that's how I do with this particular class. With my other class, we have reflections as well. Those particular reflections are graded, and what I have them do is they have to write like a 500-word reflection on the unit. Now, because it's a reflection, it's something that's personal, I don't grade them on the content itself, but what I might do is say, okay, you have to be honest, it's a place for you to reflect, with me, but what I will focus on is that, you still need to proofread your work, and I will maybe knock points off for like grammatical or mechanics errors. So if you're grading, you're restricted to what you're grading on, but there are areas that you can grade in terms of reflection.
And then there's a question that came on very early on in the webinar. Do you have any specific citation style usage?
In my classes, and again, I should have, they can't put the, citation, here. With my students, I typically have students from different majors. My teaching is effectively writing, really writing across the curriculum. So I have different students coming in who are majoring, in different areas. So depending on what their major is, will be dependent on what citation style they use. So, for example, if I have a class that has education majors, and education majors use APA style. But more recently, I've had classes where I have students with different styles coming in. So, I have them ensure that they write the citation style according to their major's requirements.
Okay. Does anyone else have any questions for Marcie? I definitely see some contributions in the chat. Which are some great comments. But are there any questions that I've missed? Okay. There's a question earlier from Terry. Grading collaborative assignments always a problem because one student doesn't do the work or does very little. Any suggestions for how to handle?
That's a super question. In the online classes, for example, I had that one group task where each student had to, you know, go and find some information. The responsibility was on each student to contribute to the acquisition of, you know, to contribute to the research in that particular given area. So, you know, that ensures that they are functioning as part of a group. With the wiki, I did that particular one because I know how difficult it is. With that particular one, I had them do it in class, and when they presented, I said to them, you need to make sure that every one of you has to say something, has to contribute to that presentation. So, you know, then of course I'm there and I can go around and I can see, you know what they're doing. But with that particular wiki, it was part of the class. It wasn't a gradable thing. And I tell you that, you know, in Collaborate, I've done exactly the same thing. When I've given live classes, I send students into breakout rooms, and it's part of the class. It's not a separate homework type assignment. It's something that they do immediately, and then we come back and address, you know, the
okay, question from Carl that came in earlier too, and thank you for reposting, Carl. In basic level courses, don't you have to ask basic questions?
Can you sort of be more specific about that? What do you mean, basic level courses to ask basic level questions?
All right, let's see if he's, well, we'll give him a, yeah. So Carl, if you could add more to your question, then Marcie can answer that. In the meantime, Etta asks, do you use rubrics and provide them to students?
Absolutely, absolutely. We have rubrics for the narrative, for example. The online classes, you know, their rubrics, you know, they are graded on the quality and the participation, in the online classes. They have in every task that's given, there are set requirements that you have to, you know, have a certain number of words when you post an entry, that you respond to your peers in no less than certain words, and post by a particular, you know, post your entry by a particular time, post your responses by a particular time, and they are graded. You know, on that, absolutely. And that's just one rubric. I have, you know, about four rubrics in my classes addressing different things, whether it's a narrative or presentation, research paper, or online classes. And one of my classes has a participation rubric, you know, as well.
Okay, yes, great. Yes, so there's another question from Christina. Do you feel that it's best to try and create assignments with specific parts where each person in the group chooses and is responsible for a specific part rather than just grading on the whole?
Do you feel that it is best to try and create assignments with specific parts where each person in the group chooses and is responsible for a specific part rather than grading on the whole? Right, so basically assigning tasks and giving students different roles in that assignment, that's kind of how I interpret that. I haven't done that in these particular examples. I have done so, you know, when students have built, you know, projects and they've had like clearly defined, you know, roles that are different, you know, in those projects. It's really hard, actually. I find it really hard to kind of sort of grade, you know, in those circumstances. You have to make sure that the roles that you give are equally balanced, you know, between them. But I haven't, in English, for example, I haven't given that particular type of assignment. It's kind of sort of collaboratively in getting sort of information together and analyzing it and interpreting the information.
Okay, question from Carl. I think that this was related to the earlier one. You were talking about students interpreting data, but don't they need to learn the data first?
Well, that's what interpretation is. It's a form. So when you have, so if you're given, for example, a story for students to read, what one could say, what does this story mean? You know, to illustrate to me that you comprehend this story, that you understand the story. But ultimately, you know, instead of using the word understand, because if I use the word understand, that implies there's only one meaning in that story, that, you know, and that the students, especially in English class, have to find out what that particular one meaning is. If they feel that they can't find that one particular meaning, that they, you know, may feel intimidated by the material. So instead of using the word understand, you know, essentially what students are doing are, how do, you know, they're looking for comprehension, of course, but how do I interpret it? What does, how do I understand this material? And they use strategies like summarizing, explaining, you know, which is, of course, a form of interpreting the material, and as such, communicating that material and their own understanding of that material to others. I hope that answered your question. So I use interpreting instead of, you know, understanding, especially when, you know, you're dealing in English.
Okay, so Terry asked, thanks for the idea. Do you think collaboration would be better if each group member took a turn being responsible for an entire portion of the project? In other words, if the project has four parts, each group member gets a turn as a collector and submitter, thus generating the official group response and grade. I'm thinking in this case, each student would get the experience of depending on the others to do their part.
I think that's a great idea, you know, building projects where you have role, like the students maybe switch the roles, but you know, that I would imagine would be a big project as well, to enable students to, you know, to engage in that type of project.
Thanks. It looks like Mary Louise posted a link to citation and reference generator.
I see that I don't use the citation websites. I use the manuals, you know, in my classes. So I always, you know, have the students, you know, learn how to manually do it, just in case. When, you know, sometimes with, you know, some online cases, it's not, you know, always, you know, could be varied.
Are there any other questions? Okay, I'll give it one more minute and then we will wrap up for today. Thank you, Lana. That was a good, great comment. It just says be careful with the generators. Those turn the references gray and instructors cannot comment on them.
Right.
So it looks like there might be a few more comments coming in. I can see people typing.
Yeah, I just see that they've got lots of different you know, citations that you can use for the Bloom's taxonomy.
Okay. Well, I want to thank you so much, Marcie. This was just a great presentation. A lot of people have also said thank you in the chat window if you haven't already seen that. So I really, you know, appreciate you taking the time to share your experience with everyone today. This session has been recorded, so we will convert it into a YouTube video and get it posted out there, and make sure that everybody gets a copy of it. So with that, I want to thank you so much again, Marcie, and until next week. Thank you so much, everyone, for joining.
Thank you, Sharon.